गुड मॉर्निंग, आई एम डॉक्टर डब्ल्यू वी गुरुदे फ्रॉम कमला नेहरू महाविद्यालय नागपुर। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द क्रिस्टल फील्ड थियरी ऑफ कॉम्प्लेक्सेस। एज वी नो देर आर डिफरेंट थियरीज, वैलेंस बॉन्ड थियरी, मॉलिक्यूलर ऑर्बिटल थियरी, क्रिस्टल फील्ड थियरी, लिगैंड फील्ड थियरी एंड एडजस्टर क्रिस्टल फील्ड थियरी। बट नाउ टुडे आई एम गिविंग टू गिव डिटेल्स अबाउट द हाउ द स्प्लिटिंग ऑफ डी ऑर्बिटल टेक प्लेस इन द कॉम्प्लेक्सेस। So today's topic is the crystal field theory of complexes, and in the next slide now, when we are discussing crystal field theory of complexes, or to form the complex, we should have to discuss some basic concept. And here, the chemical bond. So every species, when the chemical species, two or more chemical species combine together, they form the force of attraction between these two chemical species is known as the chemical bond. And this may be between the two atoms or two molecules. And this chemical force can be of different types, and there are different types of bonding, as we know, in the chemical bonds. And different bonds are ionic bond, covalent bond, coordinate bond, metallic bond and hydrogen. But here I am going to give details about the coordination bond, because we are going to see the formation of complex. In complexes there is a coordinate bond. Coordinate bond form in the complexes, coordinate bond is formed between metal ion and the ligand, and because of the presence of this coordinate bond, the complexes also known as coordination compound. In the next slide now, whenever we are discussing the coordination chemistry, so in complex or complex ion, there are two parts. One is metal ion and the ligand. Ligand may be of different types, and when these two combine to form this complex ion, this is negative complex ion, this is positively charged complex ion. So these are the two examples how the complex ion is there. So before going to see details about the crystal field theory or the formation of complexes, we should have to know what is the basic terms of this coordination formation of complex or coordination compounds. So first compound here is a central metal ion. These are the terminology, and as we know, central metal ion is a positively charged and which can accept electron, and this metal ion is a positively charged metal ion, sometimes we also known as a cation, which has two or more neutral molecule or negative ions, or very rarely positive ion attached to it in the coordination compounds. So this is the, and this central metal ion is present at the center of the complex, which is surrounded by the ligand. So next is the ligand, and we know that ligand is a species which is surrounded to the metal ion in the complex, and generally the ligands are of there are three different types: neutral ligands, negatively charged ligand, or rarely the positively charged ligands. But now here, this negatively charged, neutral or really positively charged, all these ligands have necessary condition is that they should have a lone pair of electron. During the formation of complex, these ligands donate electron pair to the vacant orbital of metal ion. So the important condition for the ligand that they should have a lone pair of electron. Again now here, this in the complex ion, central metal ion is surrounded by groups or the ion or molecule. This is known as the ligand. These surrounding ions or group or molecule around the central metal ion is the ligand, and ligand may be atom, ion, or sometimes cation or the molecule. Many of the properties of coordination compounds are due to the ligand. The nature and the number of donor atoms and the charge on the ligand. The common donor atoms are generally in the ligands are nitrogen, oxygen and the sulfur. Ligand may contain one donor atom, then it is known as unidentate ligand. For example, ammonia, water, F- Cl- NO2- etc. If there are two donor atoms in the ligand, then it is known as bidentate. For example, ethylene diamine. When the ligand contains two or more donor atoms, it is called multidentate, and the ligand is said to be a chelating ligand sometimes also. Finally, the charge on the ligand is important, because it determines many properties of the compound. So here, the complex contains metal ion and the ligand. So these two terms are there. Now another third one is a complex ion. Combination of metal ion and ligand together is known as the complex ion. And complex ion is itself made up of a central metal ion surrounded by other ions or molecule, which is also ligand. They always exist together as a single species. So such type of ion is known as complex ion. Another next is the coordination sphere. Now coordination sphere are formed by the ligand around the central metal ion, and here in the it is represented by the square bracket. So this bracket, inside this bracket there is a metal ion and the ligand. So this square bracket is known as a coordination sphere. Another term is contact ion. So it is opposite charge ion present outside the coordination sphere, and so such type of ion is known as contact ion. Now next is the coordination number. Coordination number is nothing but the total number of electron pair, total number of bonds present between the metal and the ligand. So this number is known as a coordination number. So coordination number, we can say that in this case also, it is the total number of unidentate ligand attached to the central metal ion. And sometimes also we say that actually coordination number represents the total number of coordinate bond that metal ion can form with the ligand. So these are the some terms of this metal these are some terms in case of this formation of complex. Now when we are discussing the coordination chemistry, the coordination compound is also there. Coordination compound is addition compound, and a compound that and also it contains complex ion and the counter ion or the ligands. And example of coordination compound are here given. Compound hexaamine cobalt chloride and tetraamine copper compounds. And now here this coordination compound can also be differentiated with the double salt. But now here coordination compound are the addition compound which do not lose their identity in the solution. And so many examples are there of the coordination compounds. Complexes are coordination compounds, and K4FeCl6 is the well-known example. Potassium ferrocyanide or hexacyanoferrate are the examples of this coordination compound. And also here two examples are given. Next, whenever we are discussing the formation of complexes, then Werner is the has given the first theory for formation of complex of coordination compound. And now Werner's theory of coordination compound, for this theory the Werner also have received a that is the he formed the complexes between cobalt and the ammonia. Between these two he formed the complex, and this Werner is the known as a father of coordination chemistry. Werner in 1893 put forward this theory of coordination in order to explain the formation and the structure of this complex compound. He was also awarded a Nobel Prize in 1913 for his outstanding contribution in the chemistry. The unique feature of this theory is that it is non-electronic in nature due to simple reason that the idea of electron was not known to the world at that time. So this is very important. Theory was given, but here we are not discussing the Werner's theory. We are going to see the crystal field theory of complexes. And as we know, there are different types of theories put forward by different scientists. And out of all these theory, we are going to see the third crystal field theory, which is given by Bating and Wallach. So this theory, before also going to discuss the crystal field theory given by Bethe and Wallach, what are the drawbacks of what are the limitations of valence bond theory, that we have to see first. Now these are the content of these presentations, and now these are the limitations of this crystal of the valence bond theory. And these limitations, some of the limitations have been minimized by crystal field theory, and these limitations are very important. In case of valence bond theory, much importance is given to the metal ion, while the role of ligand is ignored in most of the cases. The theory does not explain the magnetic behavior of the complexes. Theory also does not explain the absorption spectra of the complexes. And complex formation of in case of certain metal ion is also totally unsatisfactory, for example in case of Cu2+. Theory does not explain why the structure is D8 in case of D8 metal ion, why they have square planar, as well as they have tetrahedral. In case of T8 configuration, the complexes may have square planar or tetrahedral, but they does not explain why the particular structure is there for metal ion. The theory also could not explain the reaction rate and mechanism of the reaction. And distortion in the symmetrical complexes cannot be explained by this valence bond theory. This also theory does not explain the temperature dependence of paramagnetism of the complexes. So these are the these are the limitations of this VBT, and two important limitations, that is magnetic behavior and absorption spectra of the complexes, could not be explained by VBT. Therefore, there is a crystal free theory which minimizes these limitations and put forward a new theory given by Wanling and Bethe. And valence bond theory was, again, I can give some information about this. Valence bond theory was developed by Pauling. In coordination compound, ligand form coordinate bond to the metal. Therefore, the ligand must have empty orbital of suitable energy available for bonding. The theory considers which atomic orbital on the metal are used for bonding. From this, shape and stability of the complex are predicted. But theory was have two important limitations. That is, valence bond theory have two important limitations. Most transition metal complexes are colored, but the theory provides no explanation for their electronic spectra. This theory does not explain why magnetic properties vary with the temperature. So these two important limitations could not be given by valence bond theory. Therefore, crystal free theory has been successful in explaining the electronic spectra and magnetism of transition metal complexes. And after this now, so whenever we are discussing the crystal free theory, then there are some important features of this crystal free theory, also known as CFT. So this CFT was given by Bethe and Wanling. This theory assumes that attraction between the central metal and the ligand in complex is purely electrostatic. The transition metal in the complex is regarded as a positive ion, which is surrounded by negative ligand or neutral molecules. If the ligand is neutral molecule, such as ammonia, the negative end of the dipole in the molecule is directed towards the metal ion. So this is the CFT, which is given by Wanling and Bethe. And now there are some important, very important points of this CFT. There are four important features, and important feature out of that, first one is all ligands are treated as a negative point charge. As we know, ligands are different types, maybe negative, maybe neutral, maybe positively charged in their cases. But now in CFT, all ligands are treated as a negative point charge. And again now, second important point is that there is no any mixing of orbital of metal and ligand. Hence, there is no overlapping of orbital or mixing of orbital. There is no any orbital overlap. This is the second one. There is no mixing of orbital. There is no overlapping of orbital in the, this is the second feature. Third important is that the interaction between metal and ligand is purely electrostatic in nature. The interaction between metal ion and the ligand is purely electrostatic in nature, and therefore bond present between metal and ligand is a 100% ionic. And third is, bonding between metal ion and the ligand is purely electrostatic in nature. So these are the important features of this CFT. So again, I am repeating that all ligands are treated as a negative point charge. There is no any mixing of orbital or overlapping of the orbital between metal and the ligand. And again, the interaction between metal and ligand is purely electrostatic, and therefore the bond present is 100% ionic. So these are the important features of CFT, and based on these CFT points, we can explain the geometry and splitting of d orbital in the complexes. Now here, before going to discuss the CFT splitting of d orbital in different geometry, we should have to know what are the shapes of d orbital. As we know that there are 5 d orbital, dxy, dyz, dxz, and d square, y square, and dz square. So 5 d orbitals are there, but in case of this dxy, dyz, dxz, xy, yz, and xz, in this case the lobes of the high electron density are present between the x and y axis. So we should have to know what is the shape of d orbital. So here, in case of dxy, these lobes are present between the axes. So here dxy means because these lobes are present between x and y axis, therefore it is known as dxy. When the lobes are present between y and z, it is known as dyz or dxz. Whereas in case of the other two orbitals, that is dx square, y square and dz square, the lobes are present along the axis. Therefore, this is the difference. In case of first thing, the lobes are present between the axis. In case of these two last two d orbital, the lobes are present along the axis. This is the difference. And depending upon these shapes of d orbital, there is a splitting of d orbital in different geometries. So here now, now there is a question, why there is a splitting of d orbital in octahedral complex? We are going to see, but why there is a splitting of d orbital? Now we know that when the ligand approaches towards the metal ion, and then d orbitals have five orbitals, these five orbitals are in a free state, they are degenerate. And degeneracy of the 5d orbital can be destroyed when the ligand approaches towards the metal ion. Now the electron present in the metal ion and the negatively charged ligands, there is a repulsion between these two, and this is the repulsive force which is responsible for the splitting of d orbital in the complexes. So again, I am repeating that the electron present in the d orbital of the metal ion and the negatively charged ligands, both are the negative, electrons are negative and ligands are negative. So this negative repulsion and this repulsive force, it take place in the complex, and this repulsive force is responsible for the splitting of d orbital in the complexes. And so here, therefore, the degeneracy of the d orbital can be destroyed. Now in case of splitting of d orbital in octahedral complex, now in this is the diagram, this is a CFT diagram for this octahedral complexes. Here, this is the ground state, 3D orbital in free state. Now here, slightly energy increases here because there is a, and again these 5D orbitals are degenerate. Now the degeneracy of 5D orbital is destroyed and split up into two set of orbital, T2G set and EG set. T2G set is nothing but the DXY, DYZ, DXZ orbitals. And here the EG set of orbital is dz square and d square y square orbital. And difference between these two is known as the delta O value. Delta O is the crystal field splitting energy. And now this is the bearing center here. T2 and E is the term symbols. So now there is a question, why T2G have low energy and why EG have high energy? It depends upon the geometry of the complex. When there is an octahedral geometry and these orbitals of d orbital, 3d orbitals have very less interaction, and therefore energy decreases. When in case of these 2d orbital, the interaction with the ligands in octahedral geometry is more, and therefore energy of this eg orbital increases. So in this case, the lobes of the in case of eg, the lobes of these orbitals are along the axis and hence called axis also orbital. These dz square and d square y square orbital are and orbitals. The group theory also says that eg orbital in which e referred to the doubly degenerate set. Another thing, that is t2g set of orbital. The lobes in case of t2g set of orbital lie between the axis and are called non-axial orbital. Group theory calls these t2g orbital T2 orbital, and T2 refers to a deeply degenerate set. In case of free metal ion, all the 5D orbitals are degenerate, all the 5 orbitals are degenerate, they have same energy. In an octahedral complex, metal is at the center of octahedron and the ligands are at the 6 corners as shown in the previous figure. The lobes of the T2G or EG orbitals and present here along the axis and between the axis. So in case of EG orbital, the lobes are directly in the path of the d square and dz square orbital approaching the ligands, and therefore electron in this orbital experience greater force of repulsion as compared to those in T2G orbital, where lobes are directed in space between the path of the approaching ligand. This increase the energy of EG orbital while T2G orbital is decreased. Therefore, under the influence of octahedral ligand field, d orbitals split up into two groups of different energy. In other words, we can say that degeneracy of the 5 orbitals is removed under the influence of ligand. The separation of 5d orbitals of metal ion into two sets of having different energy is also known as crystal field splitting, which is denoted by the symbol delta O. So this is the this delta value, sometimes also known as 10 d³, and here the lower value for each electron is a 0.4 delta O, and here the value is a 0.6 delta O. So here now, we can explain this is the splitting d orbital in octet field, and this is the delta value, and also sometimes known as 10 d³ value. And these are the values, as we know, for weak field and strong field. For D1 only one spin state, T2G1 is 0, T2G1 is 0, and for one electron, value is minus 0.4 delta O. For two electron, here two electrons are there, therefore 0.8 delta O, same value is here. For three electron, minus 1.2 delta O. In this way, it is also possible to determine the values of CFSC in octet field for each system. Formation of complex ion in weak and strong field ligand. This figure shows this is the delta O in case of weak field ligand and strong field ligand. So delta O is large, and this is the low spin state, this is the high spin state. In case of low spin state, that is when the ligands are strong, then this is the low spin and high spin. So in case of low spin, delta O is large. In case of high spin, delta O is small. And another splitting of d orbital in tetrahedral complexes. And this is the when alternate corners of this alternate corner, when we join, we get a tetrahedral. 1, 2, 3, 4. We get a tetrahedral. Again, now here the splitting diagram for tetragonal is opposite to that of octahedral. In case of octahedral, T2G is having low energy, EG having high energy. But in case of this, T2G having higher energy and EG having lower energy. So exactly opposite to that octahedral geometry. So here now, for each 0.6 delta T and here 0.4 delta T for each electron pairing in the orbital. So, and this difference between these two is known as a delta T value. So energy increases, and this is the 5 delta T orbitals, and split up into two set of orbital, and two set of orbital is T2G and EG set. In this case, in tetrahedral complexes, the central metal ion is present at the center of cube. The 4 of the 8 corners of the cube are occupied by the ligand, as shown in the figure. The direction X, Y and Z point to the center of the faces of the cube. The EG orbital are point along X, Y and Z, that is the center of the faces. The T2G orbital point between X, Y and Z, that is toward the center of the edges of the cube. The direction approaches of the ligand does not coincide exactly with either EG or the T2G orbital. But T2G orbitals are nearer to the direction of the ligand than EG orbital, and therefore approach of ligand raises the energy of both the set of orbital. The energy of T2G orbital is raised most because they are close to the ligand. The crystal field splitting is the opposite to that in the octahedral complex. The energy difference between T2G and EG set of orbital in tetrahedral complexes is represented by delta T, and it is observed that delta T is less than delta O. In tetrahedral complexes, T2G orbital, although now closest to the ligand, but do not point directly at the ligand. That is, octahedral complex, there is a ligand along each axis, and in tetrahedral complex, no ligand lies directly along any axis. For this reason, and also because there are only 4 ligands in the tetrahedral complexes, the tetrahedral orbital splitting delta T is less than delta O for the same metal and the ligand. T2G orbitals are 0.4 delta T above the average energy of the two groups, and EG orbitals are 0.6 delta T below the average. All tetrahedral complexes are high spin because pairing is not energetically favorable. So again here it is possible to calculate the value of CFSC for weak field and for the strong field. For lower EG having a lower energy, for each minus 0.6 delta O value there for one electron. If there are two, then minus 1.2 delta O. For three, for low spin and high spin is possible now. This is a low spin and this is a high spin. So in this case the values are different, minus 0.8 minus 1.8. So it is also possible for all the form D1 to D10, it is possible to calculate the value of CFSC value for different configuration in CFD. So today we have discussed the crystal field theory. Before that we have seen the what are the limitations of valence bond theory, and two important limitations, that is electronic spectra and magnetic properties, is explained well in case of the crystal field theory. Now we have seen why there is a splitting of d-orbital take place and what are the important features of CFT, and again now splitting of d-orbital in octahedral geometry and splitting of d-orbital in tetrahedral geometry we have seen, and their diagram also, and how to find out the value of CFSC. Thank you.